Here we go. So, to kind of ease us into today, I was going to talk about some of my stories around kind of, well, in wildlife film, and how I've at least attempted to weave that into genuine conservation action, right? Because we all love wildlife, we all want to actually take film and make a difference, but actually how you do that is often complex and multi-layered. So, if it's okay with you today, I'm going to share some of my stories with you, and go through some of the kind of biggest ways that kind of wildlife film or natural history broadcasting is changing to try and hold more accountability and responsibility for implementing genuine change beyond just making a really kind of nice bit of visual media to come away from and to use in the public space. Before I do that, I want to start by kind of telling you a little bit more about my background. As Felix said, I work in wildlife film. I feel very lucky to have had a job as a presenter and worked in various roles, both making my own content and with broadcasting as well. But my background is as a scientist. I won't blame you at all, but Swansea University would kill me, basically, if they said, no, it's fine. It's Swansea University. Yeah, I am from Cardiff.
That's
yeah,
right.
Yeah, no, it's Swansea University, but no, that's absolutely fine. It's Swansea University where I'm doing my PhD. And just to give you a little bit of background, I'm using tri-accelerometers, so they're these tiny tags which you attach to the backs of animals, and I'm looking at penguin data at the moment, although I'm hopefully going to go on to look at African elephants, which I'll talk about in just a moment. But what you do is you attach these tiny accelerometers to the back of whatever the animal you're trying to monitor in terms of their behaviour. And my job in my scientist role is to analyse these. These are the acceleration traces. So what you're seeing here is the walking behaviour of a penguin as it's kind of walking down the beach and heading out to sea. And my project and my PhD is based around visualising that and what does that mean and try and make that appealing. And this is kind of where the excitement about intersection of science and film and storytelling comes together, and why I kind of love both realms and have try to build skills in both areas and bring them both to the table, is these are the visualizations that I'm basically creating. So what you see here is a penguin walking. So like you and I, penguins are bipedal, so they have left and right, it's two legs, so they're stepping left, right, and that's the trace that comes out when they're walking down the beach. You can imagine that. And this is kind of the raw acceleration data. Now, once they go out to sea, they obviously are out to forage, they're obviously there to feed, and they're full of fish by the time they come back. So what happens when they come back in is this is the trace walking back at the beach as they're kind of rolling in back up to the beach, back to their breeding site. You can see the big difference there. And it's a really nice example of kind of what these tri-accelerometers can do and the use of technology. But I'm really excited to kind of use my understanding, what little I have of this area of animal movement, and to apply it to hopefully storytelling as well. So one of the main interests for me is to look at elephants in high conflict areas with people. So crop raiding and fence breaking behaviour in areas of conflict, such as in Laikipia in Kenya. There's a lot we don't know about the movement of animals like elephants there in terms of their fine scale and their general overall state. So this is one of the tags we applied on the back of an elephant last year with COVID. Obviously, you couldn't get out to Kenya then, but we have numerous tags out on elephants now to monitor their behaviour, which is kind of the other side of what I do. Of course, it's just been COP26. How is everyone feeling after COP? Pretty crap? Yeah. I wanted to kind of rant about this for a minute. I think it's really important too. It was a bit of a mixed feeling. So I recognised the privilege that I had being inside COP. So I was there with COP TV. So that's run by the United Nations climate change team. And throughout the week, we interviewed a number of people, including Al Gore, who Vice President Al Gore was there, and numerous other people from Environmental Minister of Chile, those working with COI16, the youth COP, essentially, a week before Glasgow, the COP26 summit. And, you know, had the privilege to interview some amazing people. Archana Sereng, who works on the Youth Advisory Board for the UN FCCC, as well as a load of other inspiring young people. I think the general feeling from COP26 is just frustration with a lack of action and all this talk of commitments. But ultimately, I think the worst thing, you know, being inside COP, you can taught you can really get an understanding of all these various different themes. So, for example, you had Climate Finance Day and Energy Day and then Youth Empowerment Day. And there were lots of positive things to come from it. There were lots of great ideas about transitions, but actually how that reflects in reality, it's just they never quite fit together. And actually coming from COP26, what we're seeing is that not one economy is going to meet that kind of heating of only up to 1.5 degrees Celsius and above. Huge countries such as Russia, I mean, I told you I was going to run, you set me off now. But huge countries like Russia, Saudi Arabia are on the path for a 4 degrees Celsius world, which is a scary, scary thought. So I think I'm kind of talking to the wrong crowd here, but one of my main takeaways from COP26 was how can you not look to the youth and the young people who are outside of COP and absolutely furious for their futures when you are not putting your money where your mouth is, when you've got huge scary statistics coming out of COP and when we're literally running out of time. One of the most shocking things for me being there was learning about the various different impacts of those coastal communities from around the world. You may have heard of all the acronyms from COP, but one being SIDS, so Small Island Developing States. And these are the areas and coastal communities and islands where they are seeing climate change through sea level rise and coastal destruction and increasing storms the most. They're seeing the severity of those issues. Shocking facts, shocking statistics that I was learning while at COP26, such as 50 million people have been affected between 1966 and 2015, 18,000 lives lost, $43 billion in terms of storm damage and cost to the economy because of that, and over 800 climate-related disasters happened in that short amount of time. And we're still on the path for a 1.5 degrees Celsius and above world. It's absolutely horrible and shocking, but this is why we're here, and this is why events like today are so, so important, why all of you have a really significant role to play moving forward for our future. Rant over, we're going to move on to penguins. but yeah, a really shocking experience kind of being inside and hearing both good and bad, and I'm sure lots of positivity to take away from it. Speaking about positivity, wildlife film traditionally over the years has played a really unique role in changing our perception about the natural world, and there's a real hunger to understand more about a natural world with everyone here, but actually in the wider public, more so than ever. And more so than ever, we're also seeing an appetite to learn about the climate impacts as well. Just before the pandemic, I was filming with the BBC in South Georgia, and this is kind of a really unique place for me because it encapsulates kind of both the beauty and the wonder of the natural world, as well as showcasing human impact and also kind of the climate issues around these really essential places where we're seeing climate change accelerating the most. So South Georgia is very unique. I don't know how much you know about this wild place, but it's very unique in where it sits because it kind of sits northeast of the Antarctic Peninsula. And of course, one of the main foods in this part of the world is Antarctic krill. Antarctic krill, towards the end of its life cycle, when it's the largest, it's the biggest, juiciest, and when it's in its largest biomass, it will kind of drift towards the end of its life cycle upwards towards the Scotia Sea. And that's what's kind of, well, South Georgia sat right in the middle of that. So what you end up getting is a huge amount of diversity and incredible wildlife, such as penguins and whales and seals that all flourish in this place. It's an amazingly wild place. This is kind of the scene that you get when you arrive, by the way. The smell of this beach is unbelievable. This is St. Andrew's Bay, and across South Georgia there's about 500,000 penguins in the height of the breeding season. It's pretty incredible. But again, this island has been through many different phases so far. Of course, there was the rat introduction to the island, which happened and almost decimated all of the ground breeding birds on the island. There was numerous helicopters that basically had to deploy. They used these kind of tiny rat poisons, essentially, across the island to try and in one go eradicate all the rats at one time. And it was essential for the island's wildlife and birds to kind of bounce back and be at the numbers that they are today. This is a really interesting kind of timeline of that eradication programme, and I was down there learning about it, learning about that kind of transition. My favourite fact, 8,000 tea bags ordered for the field camp, necessary. But huge, huge efforts of conservationists, and one of the best success stories that actually came out from this incredible place. Again, this wasn't kind of the only transformation on South Georgia. There was also the fur seal trade, which happened back in the 1950s. That was then followed by the whaling industry. So this island, again and again, and around that island and that environment has gone through huge transformations, and every time has bounced back. So there's lots of stories in there about how nature can recover if you give it a chance, but also kind of the detrimental impacts that we're having in our environments. And the scariest one, there's actually a few chicks in here. It's a bit like Where's Wally? But there's a few fluffy chicks in here. This was kind of the scene. You can imagine the smell in this picture. But it's an amazing place. And now the scariest impact to this island is, of course, the impact on the Antarctic krill, which have steadily been declining since the 1970s and are declining at such a rate that, you know, the future of king penguins and all the other species here is rapidly changing. So I think we'll see more stories about how actually the impacts on these environments are really going to put species like this in danger moving forward. But just lots to think about one particular location. And when you're putting a story together, you can just say, aren't king penguins incredible? They're smelly, they're epic, they breed in huge numbers. But there's way more than that. And we're seeing a big shift in broadcasting to move more towards those important stories. Bringing it closer to home, how many of you have seen this picture before? Just Lucy. I know you, Luce, so that doesn't count. So this was actually in the UK, believe it or not. This was about 3 years ago. 3 years ago now? I went out with a friend called Sharkman Dan. His real name. No, it's just his known name. But he and I went round the UK because we wanted to showcase what's on our doorstep. And we decided over a week we would go across the UK documenting all the incredible things around our coast. And the plan was to go see sharks and to see breaching whales and seal colonies and seabirds and to celebrate all of that, because everyone thinks there's, you know, amazing wildlife across the world, but not in the UK, and it's absolutely not true. So we did spend 6 days travelling to see all those different animals, and on the last day we were supposed to go and see blue sharks, but the weather cut us off, unsurprisingly. So we ended up doing a shore dive instead in Cornwall and came across a giant barrel jellyfish, which was what I'm tucked behind now. Has anyone seen Father Ted, or is this the wrong crowd? Have you seen the cow scene? Really far away, too close, yeah. It is actually the same size as me, not three times the size, but it was an enormous jellyfish that we came across that ended up being actually, in terms of the campaign, which was to showcase UK wildlife, it luckily did that. I mean, the rest of the series was only seen about 100 people. Five of those people were my family. So in terms of impact, this is very much a self-led passion project, and was kind of really just to encapsulate the beauty that we have here. But luckily, the jellyfish ended up really carrying that project. But more than that, after this went a little bit viral, I was asking questions about jellyfish, because there's actually a lot we don't know about jellyfish. So I found a jellyfish scientist in Swansea, and I said, please tell me everything you know about jellyfish. And he was like, there's a lot we don't know about jellyfish. So we ended up setting up the Great British Jelly Watch Weekend. Thank you, came up with that. And that's an annual weekend around the UK where we encourage anyone and everyone to go out and record any jellyfish sightings on the beach. It's part of the Citizen Science Project with the Swansea University now and the Marine Conservation Society to better understand them, because they're not just giant floating blobs. They move through our seas and our oceans in deliberate ways. They move up and down water columns and over huge distances to feed. And they're an amazing kind of group that's often neglected in media. And I wanted to include that because, you know, this is a surprising way of kind of taking that film or that project and trying to apply it to genuine science, which is one of my biggest challenges. The other kind of area that I think is really important, if anyone in the room is interested in putting together a story or wanting to make an impact film, is thinking about the right audience. So a while ago, I learned about the shooting of seals at salmon farms, and obviously the salmon farming industry being such an important one, huge industry worth billions of pounds, and actually integral to the livelihoods of so many people in Scotland and across the world. This is a kind of a really big topic. But I didn't know that, you know, salmon farms end up shooting seals. Put your hand up if you knew that. Yeah. Lucy? So obviously seals are one of our most incredible marine mammals around our coast. And of course, if they're going to see a bowl of readily available fish in the sea, just sat there waiting to be eaten, they're going to try and get into a salmon farm and eat that salmon. Unfortunately for the salmon farmer, that is hugely costly. If their salmon farm net breaks, that's a massive cost to them. And for a very long time, there was a license put in place from the Scottish Government to shoot seals. That actually ended last year due to a number of kind of different factors, which I won't go into now. But I ended up making a short film, actually two films, on the shooting of seals at salmon farms, because I thought, do people even know this is happening? And why is it happening? It was kind of, for me, one of my most important projects, because it was aimed at the Scottish Government, and it was kind of an impact film that I felt really, really passionately about. And there were certain kind of issues still to kind of iron out within that. So, for example, there were dead seals washing up on the beaches that no one was kind of saying, well, no one knew why they were dead on the beach or how they actually got there or who shot them. So there's a lack of accountability there. And there was out of sight, out of mind, right? Many of you didn't realise that's a reality at salmon farms. And I think a lot of that kind of was unseen. So it was a really interesting film, which was targeted, as I say, to the Scottish Government and ended up reaching the Scottish Government and reaching the salmon farm who we featured in the initial film we made. And then again in Billion Pound Fish. And it ended up in that salmon farm actually saying, yeah, look, they got fined. They went to court, they got fined, and they ended up moving their salmon pen. I'm not saying this to say, God, look how brilliant that film is and the impact of that. In fact, it's quite the opposite, because, you know, here I stand 2 years later scratching my head on how to make this film bigger and better, because we're still seeing illegal activities of shooting seals at salmon farms. We're still seeing an industry which is so enormous and having so many different impacts of it on our environment, from destroying seabeds to, kind of mixing with wild populations of wild salmon here in Scotland. And of course, this problem translates across in all the other places where you get salmon farming as well. So Chile, Norway and Canada as well. So I think in terms of when you go out and if you have like an issue or a project that you're really passionate about, think about your audience, think about how you're going to put that story together. And if it is kind of to government or has a kind of political undertone to that film, really think about how you're going to put that forward and how you want change to happen. Because it could even be something like, hey, do you know salmon farms shoot seals? And that could be enough to galvanise enough action or conversation online to reach the necessary government or whoever it may be. We are going to whiz through, as I say, the very surface level whiz through various projects. I want to talk a little bit about characters and character-led pieces. So one of my favourite things that we have here in the UK, of course, is our orca. And I think a lot of people go to far-flung places to see orca. And this summer I said, right, that's it. You know, I've seen orca all over the world, but what about in Shetland here in the UK? And the story that I kind of wanted to base it around was very much about human connection and wildlife. And sometimes in these big kind of documentaries, it's missed. It's a missed part of the story, but such an important narrative and such an important part of that kind of character-led piece. And of course, in broadcasting, if you have one person's story to follow, sometimes it makes it easier for an audience to be connected and have that emotional connection with that story. But that doesn't always have to be a human either. That can be an animal. So this is a pod of, they're called the 27s. They're a pod that live up in Shetland. This was drone footage we took in the summer months. And the whole film was based around the community up here that They basically go out as much as they can to document, to photograph this pod and the other pods around Shetland, to understand their behaviour, to know about their movements. This community-led conservation has ended up in there being a detailed understanding of the orca around the coast, the west coast of Scotland, the Iceland, the pods that kind of go from Iceland and back to Shetland. An amazing, amazing community that have come together themselves. They're made up of conservationists, just passionate naturalists, photographers, scientists, everyone. And the 27's featured as a bit of a kind of character-led pod in that, because they're a very well-known pod up in Shetland. An example of a kind of character that fits into all of this is an orca, which still has eluded me to this day. I've tried to see him so many times up in Scotland. His name is John Coe, and he is this amazing male orca. He's one of two left of a pod called the West Coast Community Pod. Unfortunately, the West Coast Community Pod, which were actually, I believe, 10 individuals, are now down to just these two males. The female was called Lulu, and she unfortunately died because she had such high level of PCBs in her tissues that she wasn't able to have any more young. She ended up actually dying due to entanglement, and as a result, the numbers in this pod that exists today in Scotland whittled down to just these two individuals. And John Coe features so heavily in the lives and the communities of so many across Ireland. He's gone down recently, you may have seen him in the news, going down to Cornwall, he went past Wales, he's up in Scotland. And so the plan is to hopefully feature a story next on John Coe to showcase all of the issues around the orca that we have here in the UK. And unfortunately, it will be the end of the West Coast Community Pod specifically because of all these issues. So we'll be bringing all of that in as well. We're currently working on... Does anyone know what this is? That's a guy. Yeah, this is a bearded vulture. And I absolutely love them. You may have seen the bearded vulture that came last year to the Peak District. It was so amazing to see that juvenile that wandered over and stayed for the summer months in the Peak District. And off the back of that, I've been in touch with the Vulture Conservation Foundation. This is kind of talking about character-led stories, because we're putting together a short documentary about the reintroduction and the amazing conservation work that's gone into bringing back the bearded vulture across the Pyrenees and across Europe. One of the unique stories that we weren't able to go out and film last year, but set up 4K nest cameras actually at the breeding centre that they have there with the Vulture Conservation Foundation, was this relationship between Alex and Casaggio. So this is Casaggio, bearded vulture, he's a male, and he's imprinted on Alex, and Alex sits in the nest with Casaggio every breeding season. And he gets very bored, as you can imagine, because he spends hours there. But they have a really unique relationship, and Alex will sit in the nest throughout the breeding season, socialising and rearing a fake egg until it's ready to actually, well, until they have a young chick, which they are hoping to kind of breed at the facilities and then release back into the wild. And when the time's right, Alex will come in with a little bag and he will replace that fake egg with a real chick. And then that Casaggio will help rear that chick. He's an amazing, amazing dad. And they have a really unique relationship there. So one of we are telling his story. We're telling the story of the bearded vulture within this kind of bigger project. And it will actually end with hiking up into the mountains with what's called a bearded vulture backpack. An adaptive backpack carrying the juvenile before he's fledged up into the mountains in the Pyrenees, and releasing that juvenile that essentially we've reared along the way back into the Pyrenees to showcase that. So a big part of that story is following Alex's journey, who's been integral to the bounce back of bearded vultures, as well as the other individuals who have been really important part of that. But again, an example of how kind of establishing emotional connection, very much marked Bus Teacher, but this time with vultures, hooray! but establishing that connection with people and wildlife, or transforming it and just picking an individual animal instead. You know, following that character-led story is important for wildlife film, and to get people to notice, to create that impact that you need to go on to help in conservation. I also want to mention as well that this was a project we did last year, with National Geographic. It was a live series called Meet the Expert. And so often, and I'm sure so Lucy, who also works in production, she knows as well the importance of having good relationships with your contributors. There's many scientists and those who have scientific backgrounds in the room. And I don't know how many times you've been approached by media or if you have any experience with that. But it's so important to get that right, because this is the work of an individual or an organisation or a group or university that have been working on this project for all of their lives. You know, this is years and years of work, research, funding, time. And there has been moments, unfortunately, where there's been breakdown of that relationship. And I, you know, whether you're coming at it from a scientist perspective or a kind of production perspective, that relationship is so integral to tell the right story about a species or, you know, about a conservation message. And you've all seen, you know, the sensationalised headlines of various stories and how it actually can be very detrimental for conservation overall. And so it's so critical to get that right. That has never been kind of more true with National Geographic, that we're very, very specific about who we spoke to and the science stories we told as part of that live series. I would highly recommend it. Going to watch it. Dr. Ray is an amazing bear biologist. She's incredible. And does amazing work with bears. But an example of how that hasn't always gone to plan is a research project that was led by the incredible ornithologist Jamie Dunning. You may have heard of him and his work, but he, by the way, that is a real puffin wearing sunglasses. That's part of a research project or a new bit of research that came out about puffin bills that actually glow under UV light. So Jamie Dunning, amazing, as I say, amazing ornithologist, was in a museum and he was shining a UV light over the crests and the bills and the wings of various birds in a collection. And he found that you get this amazing kind of fluorescence appearing. And so he did some experiments. Basically, the puffin has a shield over its eyes because you can't use UV light on real puffins. It gives them cataracts, so it's just a safety thing. But when this came out, you can imagine the media kind of exploded. There was so much attention around it, and he hadn't even published his paper. So there was a bit of kind of... I went to go film with him about 6 months, 7 months after he actually found this out, and he was explaining that there's big issues with that because the news was saying there's like party puffins all over Scomer Island and all over the UK, you know, and there was fear that there'd be people shining UV lights at puffins to get their bills to glow and all the rest of it, which obviously is a big kind of health risk. But unfortunately, that ended up having a massive negative effect on a genuine bit of research, which is fascinating, but also really important for him and his career and that relationship as well is so, so important. So it's just an example, you know, when we went to go film with him for BBC Earth, we did a video on that and about the science behind it, but he was explaining how tough it can be. A similar thing, does anyone know what egg this is? I'm not looking at Lucy. Do you want to know what this is? One of the most beautiful eggs in the natural world. No, this is a guillemot egg. So off Scomer Island in Wales, amazingly wild island, there's an amazing amount of seabirds, and they actually lay these beautiful eggs. And there's been many theories. It's kind of a similar situation where Tim Burkhead, who's led the research for over 30 years on the evolution of the guillemot egg, he's suggested many theories, but the main theory of the shape of this kind of conical egg is that it basically doesn't move. It's the most stable shape of any egg as it sits on a very steep ledge, which they do, guillemots. They all kind of nest closely together. But unfortunately, again, he's had issues with various different theories coming out and over the years has had to kind of fight his corner. So I think in wildlife film, and for any of you who wanted to put a story together, definitely take the time to build a relationship with your contributor or with a science project. And if you are coming in from a science perspective, you'll know what it's like. You know how important it is to ensure that you're protecting that. So, you know, have that understanding, use that advantage to bring that to the table if you are going to work in wildlife film or put a wildlife film story together. In the lockdown, this was a really kind of brilliant project that I was very lucky to be a part of, but I think one of the things that the lockdown showed us was that obviously in TV and broadcasting, we don't necessarily need to travel in huge numbers on a huge scale with a massive budget and have hugely kind of huge emissions in making films to put them together. You can actually adapt. You know, Springwatch showed us that, how they're able to have remote presenters in various locations and do so while reducing emissions, reducing travel. One of the challenges that the Wildlife Trust of South and West Wales had was, well, we've just lost all our income from tourism. How do we showcase the wildlife and do so on a kind of a high level and into people's homes during the pandemic? So we set up SCOMA Live, which was a 14-week series. It just got a bit silly in the end. It was very long, but it was great because we did a 14-episode series where we set up live cameras on the island at boroughs to bring wildlife to people wherever they were. The series ended up, you know, raising £100,000 for the charity. It was a great opportunity to talk about the wildlife all day long while I was stuck at home. And actually, we learnt new things as well about the behaviours of animals like puffins. So we didn't realise that puffins sleep outside their burrows at night time, but apparently they do. So that was captured from these live cameras. And I wanted to include that because I think as we move forward in the wildlife film industry, many people are going to be looking at us to say, well, how are you going to be bettering yourself and stepping up to the plate and how you make these productions? And there are big steps being taken in the industry now. And, you know, for myself as well as an individual and a freelancer and someone who's going to make my own films, it's a massive, massive responsibility to ensure you're doing it right and ensuring that you have as low emissions as possible. And also just changing the whole system in the sense that why can't we have camera teams who already live in Kenya, who, say, for example, know their wildlife, who have the skills, who want to go into wildlife film? Why can't we upskill them and use them instead of shipping someone from Bristol, you know, across the world to do it? So I think there's kind of big changes happening in the industry, and the last year has definitely shown us that. So that was kind of a whiz-stop tour through some of my projects. As I say, they're all kind of, there's a bit of a mix of professional and both personal, but they're all attempts, I think, to try and figure out how best to put together genuine impact in conservation. It can come in many forms. And some of you here today may be thinking about, well, I'm hoping that all of you will be thinking about media in some capacity, but you may be thinking about going into wildlife film, perhaps presenting a little bit about your research or whatever it may be. Utilise that tool. It's a brilliant tool. It's really, really important as we need to kind of really put the pressure on and continue the motivation for the public to want to make a difference. But my kind of top bit of advice would be, you know, if you have a passionate story to tell, figure out how to kind of get one storyline. Utilise other young people who are equally in the same position as you and want to upskill and learn how to tell a story as well. I mean, you've literally shown us how you guys have set up this amazing, you know, organisation, this amazing board and this amazing event today because you can and because, you know, you've gone out and actually just taken it on. So, thank you for listening. And if anyone has any questions, fire away.